Hi, G.I., welcome home. Ray Bakerton again with the Wounded Artist Project, and today we're with Miss Bonnie Miljour.
Yes.
Bonnie,
that's
thank, you for, thank you for joining us today.
You're welcome.
And Bonnie is a scientific illustrator. And Bonnie, what is your title and where are we at right now?
Well, we are in the Museum of Paleontology at the University of Michigan, and my title, my working title is Senior Scientific Illustrator.
Very good. Thank you very much for the invite. I appreciate your wanting to work with us.
Mm-hmm.
And again, Bonnie is a scientific illustrator. We've done videos speaking with architects for those of you that like perspective drawing. Lawrence Tech has helped us out with transportation design for those of you that like fill sketchbooks with cards. But today we're going to be talking about all different kinds of science drawings. And Bonnie, you've actually owned a bat at one time because a BAT bat, flying bat, because mm-hmm. of your work as a scientific illustrator. And right now, Bonnie's working. You are working on Tyrannosaurus Rex pieces. There's a another fossilized set of bones here for what was it again?
It's a whale.
An ancient whale. And we're going to get some samples of her work later, and we're also going to see her work on a computer. But instead of discussing the computer this instant, Bonnie, we want to get our kids thinking about working with pencil and paper. Mm-hmm. And in order to do that, we want to ask what was your start with drawing, and can you bring us up to where we are today? When did you start drawing?
I started drawing when I was real young, when I was still sleeping in my crib, actually. I would climb out of the crib every morning and go sit in front of the kitchen window and draw. So I always had an idea that that's what I wanted to do. And I always thought that I wanted to be an artist, and I wasn't sure what that meant at that age, but I do now. So I've been drawing ever since I can remember, but this is the first job that I've had that asks me to draw, you know, for a profession.
Mm-hmm.
Up until now, I worked in book manufacturing, and then I went from that to this job, and that was 20 years ago. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I love this job.
Okay, well, and again, in the scientific illustrator position, you don't necessarily have a college degree to do this. You just have to be a very, very good artist.
Yes, I mean, if you can draw and you can prove that you can draw by showing your work, you have to have a portfolio. And if it's good, it will impress people.
Mm-hmm.
It will speak for itself. You also have to, I think, well, it's good if you have a nature that is easy to get along with, because you're going to work with many different kinds of people. And all of them are perfectionists, pretty much.
So they can be pretty critical.
They have to be, yeah.
Right.
Because it's their name on the line. So many times I have to do something over, or do a lot of fix-up to the point where I think, oh, I'm going to make a hole in the paper. You know, but I always think, it doesn't matter. This is my job. I'm being paid for it. And, you know, so what?
Mm-hmm.
Whatever I'm drawing is.
Mm-hmm. And you mentioned earlier, before we started rolling the film, that you've had jobs where I just had to go there because I had to go there. But today it's like,
yeah.
I have to go there, but I love drawing.
Yeah, so. I do. I can't think of a better job, really. I mean, like Ray was saying, any other job I held in the past was just that. Like, I went to work because I had to have the money to live, but I didn't think of it as anything special or highly desirable. But this job is a career, and it's much, much more fulfilling. Also, I know that the things that I'm producing here go into scientific publications, and those things will outlive me by a long time. I know that because we use things now that were published in the 1800s, drawings.
Really?
The text gets old fairly quickly,
mm-hmm.
outdated, but
right.
the drawings, they are what they are.
Really?
That doesn't change.
And one of the other aspects about scientific illustration you mentioned is that you have to be able to keep certain things rather secretive, because we're dealing with publishing and
mm-hmm.
people getting credentials, so you can't really, I mean, there's items here that, you know, we were talking about before,
mm-hmm.
Like there's a picture, that a series of pictures you're doing there that you can't really discuss right now because they haven't been published yet. So.
Right.
People still have to be able to count on you to, you know, do the work and be
discreet,
yeah, and you know,
yeah.
not really broadcast what you're doing. So,
right.
And really looking at your work here, This is a nice work surface for your typical Scientific Illustrator, I guess.
Mm-hmm.
And this is typical of Bonnie's work. I want to be careful. This is an original piece of artwork. And Bonnie, maybe I shouldn't hold my hands on the back,
but that's fine.
But Bonnie was mentioning that these are all drawn on the same page. It's not like it's a collection, you know, she took one and drew it, you know, drew one skull this big and shrunk it down and put it onto a piece of paper. Those are all four separate illustrations on the same page. Beautiful piece of work. We can expand this.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yes,
that'll be on our video. And you know, the typical tools of the trade, things you get, as a car designer, I don't know if you'd have a T-Rex bone on your desk, but apparently that is. And what part of the animal is that?
It's what, a small toe bone. So, you know, it's a big guy.
We don't know that part yet.
No,
so.
We don't.
And I mentioned a minute ago, there's a set of drawings over here that, you know, you can't really describe it. You can't show us, but you want to describe briefly what they are?
Yeah, it's just some drawings of it's a bone from the leg of a bird, and we don't know what kind of bird it might have been. It was fairly large, and somebody suggested maybe something like a raptor, but, you know, until now, a lot of research has to be done now.
Mm-hmm.
They find the bone, they bring it home, and then it's a matter of, you know, lots and lots of hard work to find out just what it is and exactly where it fits in.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Now, you said it was a leg bone, but it was like that long.
Well, yeah, there's more than one bone in the leg, so, you know, there's a joint there too, so, you know, it was a big bird, like an ostrich probably.
But still something with a lot of teeth.
Yeah, or talons or something, probably, yeah.
Something pretty scary.
I suppose.
But this is the kind of work that you get occasionally, or?
All the time.
All the time.
Yeah, there are always strange things coming in here. One day it'll be, you know, a 50-foot long whale. I've had this room filled with, you know, whale bones from the head all the way down to what we had at the tail.
Really?
Trying to figure out what the whole thing looked like, you know.
But were segments missing because they couldn't pack them out? We talked earlier about that.
There usually are some things missing. Sometimes they get complete fossils.
Mm-hmm.
It's not unheard of, but because of the nature of the thing, I mean, it's been there for maybe millions of years, and, you know, these things were swimming, you know, in an ocean, which is now a desert, so, you know, a lot of time has passed.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of the animals, after they die, they've been torn apart by other animals.
Mm-hmm.
If it's a whale, you know, maybe sharks pull it apart.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
It's scattered around, but sometimes you'll see a whole thing just kind of laid out there. I've never seen it.
Mm-hmm. So you have the whole floor. This is a fairly good sized room, too.
Yeah. I never know what's coming. Sometimes I had some little teeth that were so small that they were from, I think, a little insectivore, and they were so small that they mounted the jawbone, the whole jaw, on the head of a pin, and I drew it under high magnification. It was a horrible thing to draw because there was so much distortion.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and then.
But.
And that was one of the more interesting projects you had.
Well, every project becomes interesting. You know, it's like almost like a treasure hunt, because when you look at it, you know, the fossil, whatever the project is, it's usually drawing a fossil of some kind, interpreting something. I always think, first of all, how am I going to approach this? Every project is different, you know, because I have different materials. I might have photographs, and that's all. I might have a cast, but no real object in front of me, so it's all one color. If you have, you don't pick up certain things if it's like all gray, like this.
Right.
It's all gray. But it's nice because I have the actual fossil too. I can learn a lot more about it. I can distinguish one thing from another by having the color version also.
Mm-hmm.
But sometimes I don't have that. I never know. Sometimes what I have is apart from one animal, park from the right side and park from the left side, make it the right side, keep the lighting right. You mm-hmm. know? Mm-hmm. It's a lot of little, you know, a lot of little tricks fooling around like that to
right.
get a whole picture.